My name is Rick. Last name's Harris, if you care. And so I'm talking about reverse engineering and the tools that you can use for doing that. So you guys have already had crackme projects, right? How many actually did them? Okay, because they're optional, right? So, okay. All right. How many like them? Good. Yeah, they are. So the first time I did reverse engineering, or the crackme project, actually I think it was, the project was called Don't Hate the Hacker, Hate the Code. The first one took me like a long time, too many hours. I was sitting there, because I didn't understand it. I was probably in the same boat as a lot of you, looking at like assembly code and like, what the heck is this doing? So luckily there's tools that make things a little simpler sometimes. So crackme 2, I actually solved in under an hour. It was probably more like 15 minutes, but I'm giving Julian the benefit of the doubt. So with the extra 45. But that was because there was a tool that was there to make it easy. So when you start a reverse engineering project, what do you know about the program? The file name? Yeah. Good. So you basically know nothing about the program, right? You don't know what it's going to do. And ultimately, you don't, other than what you're told in like the projects, you don't necessarily know what you're trying to accomplish. You're kind of starting from scratch. So one of the big things is that like assumptions are dangerous. And one of those dangers is you're assuming the program is not meant to hurt you. Right? So if you run the program, did you guys have the file that auto-deleted? Did you get it? No? Yeah. So good luck. That's down the road. But yeah, like there's you run a program, you don't know what it's necessarily going to do. So in that particular instance, there's, for me, an earlier one, like, so I learned it pretty quickly that backups, isolating the file from your file system. Because if you're trying to reverse engineer something and it's like malicious, right, it could delete your entire file system. So you can solve that by running it in like Docker or a VM, basically trying to isolate it from your core OS. Because if you run it on your system, then it could be bad. So yeah, assumptions are dangerous. The other side of that is that if you think you know what is going to happen, and like it could take you down the wrong path. One of the crackme projects took me way too long, just because I was trying to go a different path, like what had worked for me before, and that's not necessarily what's good. So you don't take assumptions from past projects, from previous experiences. Just kind of you can take lessons that you've learned, but don't like do too much, don't assume too much. But yeah, learn from documentation. One of the big things you can learn from is what the program tells you. So there's this thing called user experience, right? People try to make things easy for users. The downside of that is it ultimately tells a lot about what they're doing, like what the program itself is doing. So from the user experience side, they try to make it as simple as possible, but then they're giving away information. So you can actually, in a reverse engineering situation, learn from the messages that it outputs. So one of those might be like, how to enter the password, right? So one of the crackme projects said usage, put the name of the file and then the password after it, right? That was at least in my experience. So some of this has changed since all of that. I don't want that to fall over. But yeah, so just like let the program talk. The other thing is from the actual code. So when you actually get into object dump or GDB. We're also going to look at radar, is what I've heard it called. And we're going to look at these programs and actually look at the assembly code and try to understand what's happening. And we'll go from there. So any questions to this point? Any thoughts? Okay, one question I have for you guys is, in the projects that you've had, what was the most frustrating thing you ran into?
Assembly code.
Assembly code itself, okay.
Trying to read assembly code.
All right, good. Anything else?
I guess, how to use GDB. Okay. How to use GDB.
Good.
Then just on top of that, just exactly what each one, each like function that they give us like to help us, what it does and like, when is the best case to use one of those things over the other? Or like just kind of where to start, even sometimes, like right, like.
Right. Good. Okay.
The project.
Just everything about it. All right. Well, that's fine. Okay. Well, one of the things too about reverse engineering is when you're going through the process, don't assume it's always going to do the same thing. So like. It's kind of like a combination lock where you're, at least in the movies, you get your stethoscope on, and you're listening to the lock as you turn the knob and wait for that little click sound, right? It's the idea of where you find the next point in the code, and then you kind of start fresh, go back through some of the same things that you've already looked at. And so CrackMe 2, we're going to take a look at that one here. CrackMe 2 can actually be solved completely using ltrace. So we're just going to do that quick, just to get it out of the way. So who wants to talk about what ltrace does? Anybody know? Who's heard of it? Heard of it? OK. That's strace, I think, actually.
Yeah, libraries.
Libraries, yep. So it runs the program. And it listens for library calls. And so library calls are basically printf, you know, if you're using printf, or puts, or string compare. I don't know if you guys gotten to be able to use that yet. You've probably had to write some of these on your own. But anything that's like in includes, basically, is going to listen for those things and then put out the information that you're sending to it. So sometimes it's in plain text, sometimes it's in encrypted text. It all depends on what the program itself has done. So we're going to start out with ltrace and just run that with CrackMe 2. All right. So when we first run ltrace, we get basically a lot of string n comparisons, or strn comparisons, which is comparing the first 9 characters of every string. It's comparing a whole bunch of different things in the first option against password equals. So when you see that, my first thought goes to environment variables. So it's looking to the environment that you're in to see if there is the value of or the key password in it. And then it says access denied at the bottom, outputs that to the standard output. So if you just run the program itself, all you get is access denied. So what I would do then, if I'm just trying to solve using ltrace, is go ahead and set a value in the environment. So export password equals, and I just like to set a known value. And then do that. Try running. Still not accessible. So let's run ltrace again. And this is where, like, just because you've set something, you go back and you do it again to see if anything's changed. And in this case, it did. So we're seeing more. We're seeing references to MD5 initialization, a string length call to see how long the string text is, and it returns a value of 4. Update final MD5s, and then basically sprintf, where it's pulling off 2 characters and ultimately compiling that into a string. And then again, outputs access denied. So just kind of looking at this, we see MD5. What happens in my scenario was I knew that there was a thing called MD5 encryption, right? And so then I used the magic Google to find MD5 online. And then since it's encrypted, I mean, technically, you could say you know that the second string here is the value you put in because you see this encryption, but verification is always good. Verify your assumptions. I think Sylvan says that a lot. Hopefully, I can write that stuff right. And then, yeah, so it is confirmed that it was test. So MD5 decryption isn't actually decrypting anything. Like, it's comparing against like a database of hashes and known values. So it's not really something you could go into the code and try to see what it's doing, but there's like, it's messy and it's pointless. There's actually multiple answers I think that you could get if you try to decode that, but yeah, you won't necessarily get the right answer. Mm-hmm. So we decrypt the other side, and it returns the value of QWERTY. So then verify the assumption. So we're going to reset the value of password here to QWERTY. And then run crackme. Access granted. All right, so we know that that's the correct password, and we've solved the crackme2. But you know, that's like I said, crackme2 was pretty simple in that respect. You could see everything happening in ltrace. But there's the problem with that is that not always are you going to see library calls. People write their own functions. You're going to write everything, you know, in main. They use different ways to try to like make this not visible. So let's go deeper then. Everybody understand ltrace? What's the, go ahead.
So when you exported the environment variable, you need to do that because you saw that crackme2 was checking the path. Or
it's checking the environment.
It's checking the environment.
Okay. Yeah. So it was basically pulling in all of these values and then comparing those strings against password.
Oh, okay.
Does that make sense? Yeah. So that's more... that's something you learn as you kind of get the experience of working within the environment and working in Linux, right? You see that and you're like, oh, that looks a lot like environment variables. So if you miss that, it's perfectly fine. Like, it just means you haven't worked with the environment as much. So it's just you got to figure out what it's. Where it's getting the information then, that's kind of an extra step in the process, is you got to figure out where this data is coming from in order to really be able to answer the problem. Like, if you don't know that you need to set an environment variable, then yeah, you won't be able to get to the final solution. But export basically just sets that environment value.
It's built in, so you need to type help.
Dash H? Or just help? Done it. There you go. So, yeah, so attribute for the shell variable, basically. Cool. Other questions on ltrace? Questions on process? Like, why did I do this? Anything? Cool.
Maybe like, how would you know? Like, is that like kind of like a first step that you would go to? Would be like ltrace or, I know it's a known here, but like.
So the first step probably for me, you're taking on the assumption that the program isn't malicious, but I would try running the program first. So let me unset password here really quick. And then it just says access denied, which doesn't tell me anything. In other cases with crackme, it might have given a more valuable message. But in this case, it doesn't tell me even where to put a password or where it's looking for that information, basically. So then ltrace would be a quick tool. Again, the problem with ltrace is that you're running the program. So the next tools that we're going to look at, you can just basically look at the code and follow the process without running it. So in situations where there's potentially something actually malicious with the program, that's probably the safer route to go. So it doesn't delete everything. But at the same time, if you're working in a container or a virtual machine, then you can run it and then reinitialize if you have to. So ltrace would probably be like my second route after running the program, just to see what sort of message it gives. Other questions? Okay. So the next one we're going to look at is object dump or obj dump. So it does not run the program like itself, right? So when you run obj dump, it just dumps the information that's in the object file, binary file. So dash s is like source. And I'm just going to put the main, so you can see what information is in the .text area. So everybody run into the sections of like an assembly file, right? Didn't really understand it. OK. All right. Let's just dump source, right? So when you cat the actual binary file, you get a whole bunch of garbage, right? Like unreadable stuff. Well, this information is object dump will go and compile it into readable code. So like these are all assembly instructions and strings that it contains. So when you go object dump, and the reason why I'm doing dash s here is because it's going to organize this like garbage code, basically. And I'm just going to do the full program here just so you can see what it's doing here. So the dots are unreadable characters. So everything that was like kind of a blank space up here is now a dot here. And so still, like while it's organized and put into sections, it doesn't necessarily help you at all, right? But you can see the different pieces of the program. Some of them are default things that you don't really have to pay a lot of attention to, at least in these scenarios. It may be different in other cases outside of the school, but the main function is contained within the .text section. And any hard-coded data, so like if you put into a program hello world, right, in the string, it's going to be contained in RO data section. So let's see. Here we go. In that section. So that's anything that's hard-coded in the program. Let's see what time we're doing here. Okay. So I wrote out some basic programs here. Test.c, which basically is a very simple program. Int main void, returns zero, basically does nothing, which is cool. So we'll just run test, see, it does nothing. But if we look at object dump, then, and what I'm going to do is dash d, which is for disassemble. And then we'll do test. So now you're seeing some more syntax to it. This is actually in, there's two different types of assembly syntax, AT&T, Intel. And you're seeing some of the breakdown of the values. So like these are ASCII characters, right? Just written in hex format. So these are interpreted to XOR and then EPP, you know, and move RDX and then R9. So like these are the values that look like garbage up here that ultimately turn into the actual assembly instructions. And then when it's down to binary, these are ultimately ones and zeros, right? So this is a more readable format of what is going on at an even lower level. So that would be a pain in the butt to even attempt to try to understand. All right, so when you look at the main function of, again, this program that does nothing, so you look at the dot text, there's a bunch of different things that are still like pre-built part of the compilation, right? That are kind of default functions that have to happen for the program to run. But this is what I wrote in assembly language. So it starts the, like starts the base point of the memory, moves the start point, and then has the integer value zero, puts it in a register, and then pops off the our base point basically, and then returns the value with those two instructions. It's very like basic, right? What we end up getting in the other programs is a lot more complex to follow along with. But move. So these are called registers. Did you guys do any research on registers at all?
A little bit.
Yeah. So there's things that are going on that you don't necessarily need to know about. The two registers that like I found most useful were SI and DI. So like the last two characters here. SI is source, and then DI is destination. And these are the registers where data is moved just before a library call. So when it calls this other function, that's where it's moving the data that's going to be used in that library call. So that's going to be important later. But yeah, like the base point is basically its starting point. It opens up the I want to say memory. I don't know if that's the correct thing, but basically it opens up the space needed for the program to complete its process. So yeah, that's that. And then when you look at the RO data section, if it even has one. Dot RO data. Basically, the only information contained within that is four unreadable characters. When you look up on an ASCII table, this is something I use a lot. If I can spell, It's hard. Not that one. This one is one that I always use, but yeah, so you have the null value, 0, 0, right? And then you have start of heading, start of text. So the RO data section always starts out with this same four value sequence, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0. And it might change if there's actual header data that's there, but I haven't built a program that requires that, so it never happens. But yeah, other than that, other than those four unreadable characters, there's nothing in there. So then I built another program, test two. Oops, wrong file. All right, which includes studio or std io.h, and then the printf function, and then it has the hello world string in there. So basically, it's just going to output to standard output hello world. Right. So we break that program down. Dash. And we're going to disassemble it. And then we're going to just show the text section right now. So test two. Yeah, I'm not sure exactly the terminology, but yeah, that's the idea, is that it only shows that the section specified rather than all of this, the stuff that you may or may not be interested in. But in this case, I'm not interested in it. So a lot of things happening again, but still the main focus is on the main function here. So you're seeing the similarities between the basic program, right? Where it's kind of starting out the function and building out the space that it needs. And then you're returning the value of 0 here at the end. I would have to Google like these things to understand what they mean, but not overly critical. The main area where things are happening is right here. Actually, that last line is just setting the integer value. So when you see a dollar sign and then 0x0, that's just referring to like the actual literal integer value. Okay. So the main two lines where things are happening is right here. You have a library call, which it puts the name of the library call within the character. Symbols, whatever, less than, greater than signs. So that way you know what library call is happening. And then this is where the data is being moved into the destination register, DI. And so it's pulling from this source. So if you see 4005D4, right, over here on the left-hand side is 4005, but you don't see D4 in the initial like text section. But where you will see it is in, I'm going to switch to source because it's easier to read, the RO data section with source. You see 4005D0, right? So it says D4. So then it's basically meaning from the start point, which is 0 here. Actually, it's two characters. So this is 0, 1. It moves over 4 bits, right, is where the start point is for that string. So 0, 1, 2, 3, and then, so this is bit 4, right? So the address of this bit is 4005D4. Does that make sense? So when that's converted to actual characters, 48 is the ASCII value of H. And so then that carries over to the null terminator, which is the end of the string here. So the actual string is hello world with the null terminator at the end of 0. Cool. So basically, in the actual main function, this here is just a pointer, right? It's pointing to the RO data section of memory at this first bit, and then it's read as a string, so then it goes to the like null terminator, and that's how it knows that the full string that needs to print out is hello world, because it ends with that null terminator. And so that's where you're seeing some of the things you're learning on how to like copy a string, or like where to end recursion or whatever, like how to stop processes with that null terminator. That's how it's actually played out in memory here, is the full string is here and then ends in that null terminator. So the assembly is built on the same thing, just in it passed down to assembly, basically. So then, since that data is moved into the destination register, that's passed over to the puts function, and then it prints it out to the standard output through that library call. So that's kind of the next step up before we move to the more complex crackme2 file. And we're going to disassemble it, just looking at the text section. All right, so here's the main function, right? Whole lot more going on, even than that, within this whole process, right? It's a pain in the butt to follow. But you can basically start working through it. But one of the things that like I do too is look at the library calls that are happening, or the movements that are happening within the program, because those are kind of maybe points that you can begin to break it down. The problem that happens is assembly isn't really ordered, right? It jumps around. And sometimes more so. So there's programs or compilers that will intentionally make this so ridiculous and difficult to read that it's supposed to deter reverse engineer people who are trying to copy programs, basically. But you see the same things that you see in ltrace, right? So you see the string length comparison, except you only see it one time, which basically means that there's a loop that's happening, and that that library call is being called multiple times through that loop. You see MD5 in it. You see that the string length, where it tests how long what your input was. MD5 update, MD5 final. And then sprintf, where it's compiling the converted code, and then the actual comparison here. So lots of different things that are going on. And when you're looking at this, it comes down to either following the process of what's happening or trying to think through shortcuts. So if you're trying to find a password, the great mistake that a programmer can make is hard coding it. So let's check and see if they hard coded it, right? So I would go to the read-only data, because that's where any hard-coded strings are going to be at. And go there. All right, and so we're seeing a few different things. we're seeing access denied, we're seeing password equals. This is what the spurdef function uses to determine how much it's supposed to take off in order to apply it to the string. Seeing a unreadable like number of characters, and then access granted. So to be honest, this would probably be my first thought as to what the password is. But I wouldn't know how to put it in if I wasn't using ltrace before this, right? To like know that it was looking for that in the environment variable. But then the other thing is, you know, having looked at the actual main function and seeing MD5, that would at minimum be something I'd Google if I didn't know what it was. I would want to Google that and then see that it's an encryption type. And so then I would check basically any of the strings. The most obvious encrypted string is this one. So that would probably be the first place I'd start. But yeah, object dump, you can get to the answer, but it's definitely a lot more difficult to get there. Go ahead.
So you said you noticed the MD5 mm-hmm. stood out to you, and you're like, oh, I'm going to Google this. But like, how did that stand out to you?
So it's a library call that's happening within the program. So it's within these less than greater than signs, which means that it's being called, it's a library function. Okay. So, you know, I know what puts is, right? Just from having written code, it outputs that, but you can Google that just as easily too. I know what like string compares or string end comparison is, and then string compare, but I wouldn't necessarily know like what MD5 is. And so that would be something I would definitely Google if I wasn't aware of what MD5 encryption is. But yeah, look at any library calls that are happening. While they're not as obvious for, in object dump, they are useful here. still too, like ltrace makes it very clear any library calls that are happening. But and even like if it's calling a different section within its own code, right? You see how these have main? Like if you have a program that has a second function, right? You have your main function and then you have like check password up here. You know, it's gonna have a separate section within this assembly code with the function check password. And so the same as how this says MD5 underscore init here, it's gonna say check password in less than greater than signs as well. And so then you can know that that's another section of the code that you need to look at. But yeah, it's very, like object dump doesn't give you a lot of tools and resources to break down. It's much more like a manual process. So GDB was kind of the tool that I used the most for reverse engineering. Yeah.
Yeah, mentioning the ltrace, you know, thank you. And you said at the point, you know, you check the environmental variables, right? Because you are running in a Linux environment.
Yeah.
And now you also mentioned that, you know, the Ubuntu and the Docker, right? You know, I think the Docker, the like Ubuntu, they produce like virtual machine, right?
Right.
Like, so that, you know, a virtual machine or virtual operating system is a smaller one, or that, my question is, you know, the Docker and their product, would they help security? Because, you know, you could have like a smaller environment, right? Or more private environment away from like their original hosting environment. Would that help you with your security?
Yeah.
It will.
Yeah, using a Docker environment would be useful in that scenario.
Because your environment variables will be more private to
yeah, to
applications?
Like, I'm running in Vagrant right now, right?
Right, so, Vagrant, right, virtual machine.
Which is separate from my environment variables. Like, I have server passwords sitting on the other side, right?
Okay.
So I wouldn't want to run this program on my side of the system, because then let's say it's sending those environment variables to a remote server, right? Okay. Like, then my server passwords just got passed to this remote server. And then that it's a potential security risk. So you don't want to run a program in a an environment where there's that sort of security issue.
Okay, so that makes sense, because on your side of system, it's a virtual machine, then you are away from network, right? You have to log in there first. Otherwise, you are in the original hosting environment, you're exposed to network risk, right, kind of. So you have to go through network traffic, sort of.
I mean, there's still like a network bridge with Vagrant, and with Docker, I'm sure too. You can disable it, right?
Okay.
The level of security and steps that you'd take would depend on how much you trust the program.
Okay. So. The other one you mentioned, lots of passwords, they are not actually encrypted, right? I mean, they are like hashed, right? As you said, indexed. Do you have the system like Admin or Unix, for example, or Vagrant, do we have like a database or file where we keep those hashed key, to the password, or it's automatically generated? So I'm talking about, if it's hashed, right, it's not encrypted, it's it's less security in a way, right? It's a hash index, it's a table, basically, you can try to guess it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
So there's services online that basically compile databases of hashes and their equivalent string values. So the what that MD5 online is doing is it's taking the hash that I put in and it's comparing it against their database and they're returning the value.
Okay.
Now, like the extra level of security that's taken typically with hashes is they will salt the hash, like they'll add an additional level of encryption that even if I put in tests and it's a salted in MD5 encryption, right, it's not gonna return that value. So definitely a lot more difficult to decrypt in that scenario.
That extra level of security, who does that? The company does that? Or
yeah, it would have to be on the
inside,
the provider side.
Provider, okay.
Yep.
Would it be possible to explain salt a little more? Are we just not ready to?
Probably, yeah. That's like deeper security thing, and more than I know. So, I mean, the idea is just that it's a third thing, right? That's used to build the hash. So, the actual building of the hash is kind of a complex process, and I can't fully explain that, but it's like. A second factor of encryption. It's like having two passwords, basically. So, yeah. Other questions before we move to GDP? Cool. All right, so GDP. Is a good tool. All right, so like I said, it's the tool that I use the most. When I was reverse engineering, and it's still not even the best program to use, but it got the job done for Julian's programs. So that's where we're gonna go next here. All right, so basically with this, you just do GDB and then crackme too. And then it outputs a lot of information. There's no warranty. All right. So with GDB, like objdump, you can see the assembly instruction that exists in the main. So the way to do that in GDB is dis-ass main, and then it prints it all out. And it's just about as useful. So again, when I'm looking through this, I see the function names, right, in the less than greater than signs, see a string end comparison, puts in it string length, MD5 update, And then I also see string compare. So the two points that I would check are any string comparisons, because that's where data can leak, unwanted leaks can happen, basically. Because you're trying to compare things. And when you're talking passwords, one of the biggest mistakes a developer can make is to use the library call for string comparison for comparing a password. Because then it makes it simpler to find. So we're going to start there. So we have this address over on the left, 0x, and then 400911. So that's a reference address, basically, for where this comparison is. And the cool thing you can do with GDB that you can't do with object dump is break the program. So I'm going to set a breakpoint. There's multiple ways that you can fully type out break. You can just type B, and then I'm going to put the star to dereference the pointer, right? Pointer's coming back. And so we're going to set a breakpoint at this memory location. And then it's set. And then I'm going to run the program. And it stopped. So the cool thing that happens here is you can see the program in process. So you don't have to try to understand everything that's happening in between the points, right, and follow all the paths and jumps. But you can go straight to seeing what's actually in the information. And so when I mentioned earlier, source and destination are the two like registers to check. That's where I would go to here. So X prints a register, data that's referenced in a register. So registers hold pointers to values in memory. So I'm just going to dereference the pointer value and get the information output to the standard output, right? So that doesn't look very useful. But there's different ways to format the data, right? So this is going to be in hex format. Still not useful. X slash S is string format, right? And then we see some useful information. So we're looking at the first thing it's using, and then so we do the same thing on the other side, and it's comparing it against this. So again, the question is, where is it pulling that information? Since it has two values separated by equal sign, it looks like an environment variable, but you can print out your environment to confirm. And the first environment variable is XDG session ID. Since I'm in a different session, it's a different number. But again, you're seeing that played out here, where it's going through those values. So you can hit N to go to next, which basically takes it to the next breakpoint. But since it's in a loop, it's just taking it back to the same breakpoint. So you think maybe nothing's happening, but what's really happening is it's just cycling through all of those environment variables. So it moves on to the next one and compares it against it. It's not a match, so it just keeps cycling. So that basically would point out that that you need to set an environment value, basically there. So I'm going to go ahead and do that so we can see the next step in the process. Yes. And export password equals test. And then GDB. Break. Yes. Why, I don't know. So the question, just to reiterate for remote, is will that address persist? So I reused 400911, which is the last time I ran the program. And yes, that's the instruction point. I'm guessing 4 is just kind of like this generalized value for programs, and but I can state that absolutely. And then like 911 is the 900th character within the program, 911th character. So yeah, that's my guess, but again, that's a guess, and you can feel free to Google that later. But yeah, if I disassemble it, just to show, again, you're seeing that string comparison at the same address. So that's cool. And, but we know what that one's doing is checking for an environment variable, right? So that one isn't as useful to us anymore. We've set the value in the environment. Go ahead.
Sorry, I don't know if this is like a stupid question, but when we disassemble like longer code, there's the type return to continue.
Mm-hmm.
Is that significant or is that arbitrary? Like, so, because every time like Jenny and I see it, we just like press return, but like, is that?
So like the point of it is to break up the long instruction set so you can like see what's happening. So it's, if you can, well, I already killed it, but basically you can just as easily scroll back up, but it's gonna have that in there.
But it doesn't like, it's not like something important happened in the main function.
No.
It's just arbitrary.
Yeah, it's just part of the GDB program. Yep. All right, so, but we know what that first one is doing, and it's comparing against an environment variable value, which we've set, so, so that instruction point isn't is now known, right? We know what it's doing. So the other string comparison that we saw was later in the program, and that is here. So I would break it at that point as well. So same deals, star 0x, and then the address. Set that breakpoint. Yeah. I need to remove that. And here comes Google. Remove breakpoint GDB. So delete and then breakpoint and range. Right. So delete, breakpoint, one. So hopefully if that did what it was supposed to. It didn't give me an error, so that's cool. But we won't have that loop happening at the front. So we're going to go ahead and run the program. All right, cool. It only stopped at breakpoint 2. All right, so again, I would check the registers. At RSI and RDI. Again, not much there, but we know that strings are useful, so I'm gonna check that. And we see an encrypted string. You may not know that it's an encrypted string, but you're seeing a value that it's comparing, and you're seeing on the other side value that it's comparing. Right, so we're seeing two strings that are there. So again, the MD5 reference, since I know that's an encryption type, I would check it against the database and see that this is the string that I created and this is the value that it needs. But GDB like simplifies the entire process down to basically let's look at the string comparisons that are happening and see what values are there, and then and work from that, basically. And then you can see it in process. So it kind of simplifies it a little bit more, where you're not having to go through like every line of the assembly code to see what's going on, and you can break it just at the points of interest, basically, where you have the string comparisons or you have a function happening that you want to see what's actually in the information in the registers. So does that make sense? Go ahead. No worries.
So when you set the breakpoints, do you always want to set it when it's calling like a function?
So that depends. In this case, yes. Like that's what I would do. Because when you're making a library call, then the reason why the breaks matter is the data in the registers change, or the references in the registers change based on where it is in the program, right? So you want to break it at a point of significance and check what the information is in the register.
Because for the first crackme project, like when we were trying to set breakpoints, mm-hmm. a lot of times it wouldn't work. Like if we tried to run, it would have a lot of error messages and it just wouldn't. So like, yeah, I don't know. Okay. Like, do you know why that happens? Like we can't just like arbitrarily pick an address, right? It has to be,
right. So it has to be an instruction address. Like,
I mean, it's a number that we find over there,
uh-huh.
but like some addresses wouldn't work as a breakpoint for whatever reason, but I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. Yeah, I'm trying to think of like cases where that would be like.
Maybe if you jump.
Yeah, but somewhere that will never jump to.
If you have a go-to or jump, so that you skip the line.
Well, it stops it before the command is run. So, like, I think. I don't know. That's a good question. Like if you're referencing a data point, not like an instruction, right? Then that's not something I think you can break on. And I could be wrong on that though.
So like the point where it actually uses printf for the access granted.
Uh-huh.
Like if you try to set a jump breakpoint there, it would never get there, right? Because you're never actually gonna get there in the program with the way the jumps are set up. Like as it is right now without the proper password, it shouldn't ever get there, right?
You can set a breakpoint, it just won't ever stop.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So but it wouldn't give you an error saying that you can't do that.
Okay.
Right. Because it's a valid point to break. It's just if you don't have the right password, it's never gonna get there. But yeah, if you're trying to set a break and it's giving you an error, like I'd be interested in like what information you're setting. And I kind of want to see if, so like here's an address, right? Like I shouldn't be able to set a breakpoint here because it's an in-memory address. Like it's, yeah, let me do it. If you try to set like, huh. I'll start from the beginning. Like this cool thing?
Yeah.
Which has no line number. Yeah, if you see that again, like send me a screenshot. I'd be interested. Other questions on GDB? Go ahead.
Yeah, I know. So Google, totally gonna look up, and I'm sure they have books on GDB. But were there any resources that you found the most helpful for learning either assembly or GDB or various other tools like that? Because I was looking at for an assembly like cheat sheet kind of thing that has just like the names of the register, like what the, like when you said register base point, that one. I was having a kind of a difficult time finding those things just with Google.
There was a register resource, I'll have to refine it, that seemed helpful. But coming out of it, like, the main thing I learned was RSI and RDI, basically. So the last two characters are the actual register, and then the first character is related to the bit structure. So, like, if you're in infrastructure, so if you're in, like, a 64-bit system, then I think it's R, and then if it's 32, it's E, and, like, that character changes based upon the infrastructure. And you can see a 32-bit value on a 64-bit machine, so on and so forth. But anyway, it's a lot of information that is useful. It just depends on how deep you want to go with it. I'll research where my register information was at, and put that online, or put it in Slack. Yeah. So for in terms of general tools to learn GDB, again, it just depends on how deep you want to go with that particular program. Like, for me, I was most interested in just solving the problems. My research kind of was, how do I do this specific thing that I want to do, you know? But if you're really wanting to learn GDB, probably looking at the manual. I don't know if DigitalOcean tends to have a lot of good resources, but I don't know if they have anything on GDB or not. But I can try to find something for that as well. But with assembly, it was more of a, it's more of a thing where people created this to try to keep it simple, but more readable than digits, right? So the things generally mean something. If I go back into the main here, sub, to me, it's subtract, right? That's what I get from it. That's what it happens to be, because you have an integer value here. And it's basically taking the start point and it's subtracting that value from it. So it's kind of opening up this space in memory, right? Because the base point remains, but then that's what happens at the beginning, is it sets, clears out the base point, takes the value that's in the start point, moves it to the base point, or copies it over, right? And then it subtracts whatever value from the original value in the start point. So the base point is now where the start point was, and then the start point moves down the line. The words that are here are meant to try to make it simple. It's just not that obvious sometimes. I don't know what move Q, the difference between move and move Q is. So I would have to Google that, right? It's a data type. There you go. CMP, CMPL, these are variations that I would ultimately Google these specific things. But in terms of general resources, I don't think I used anything specific in terms of assembly. It was just mainly, if I didn't know what a function was doing, Google it, and if I cared, you know. But ultimately, I was just trying to solve a problem in this particular case. And when you come to C programs, unless you're actually trying to reverse engineer, you're ultimately debugging your own code. When you're trying to use GDB. So you kind of have a sense of what it's supposed to be doing, right? So that can help you along as well. But in when you're trying to reverse engineer with GDB, that's kind of the problem that you run into, is you'll have to get a sense of what is actually happening within the program. And that's where tools other than that can become more valuable. And I know we're past time here, so I'm gonna just quick show you like the disassembly within radar. Just so you can see what it does. So R2. That makes things a little more interesting. So it uses colors, one, so that makes it a little more like interesting to look at. But two, where it loops and jumps, it like describes that using these arrows. So it jumps from this instruction point down to this instruction point, and then continues on down from there. And so if it loops back up, like for example, here you're seeing a comparison and then a loop back up and then keeps cycling through that. So you can see some of those things. One of the other things it does that simplifies the world is if there's a string comparison, it shows you what it's comparing. So this is the value that you put in. This is the value that it's comparing against. Or I'm sorry. This is the value it's moving into the EDI register. So string dot. The only weird thing that it does that is it like strips off any like non-letter integer characters. So like on password up here, it strips off the equal sign at the end. And then on access granted, access denied, it pulls out the space. But if you actually go down to like where the data values are at here, it has that information still in it. So that colorizes, and there's a lot more to even like to radar that I haven't even touched. So like if you're really interested in reverse engineering, like basically the general theme online in response to my article was, you know, that's GDB is terrible. You shouldn't be using that if you're trying to reverse engineer. And they were like, you know, I would use something like radar. There was another one that Joe mentioned that's like a paid one, so I wouldn't bother with that. But like in terms of open source, like radar, it's RADARE2 or radar.org. Right? And I would check that out. And they have a lot of documentation. There's like resources online too for that. But yeah, if that's something you're really interested in, then I would probably start to look more at this tool. And get away from some of those basic Linux tools, basically, with GDB and objdump. Any last questions?
I do have a more general question.
So my question is not so related with reverse engineering, but have you used GDB to debug your own code? Because I've tried to make it work, haven't succeeded yet.
Okay.
And otherwise, what do you use besides printf?
Printf. That's basically what I used. I haven't used GDB to try to do that. So yeah, printf was basically like the main thing that I would go through and test with, just to get the output. See what the output was. So, yeah. I'll be honest. The only thing I used GDB for was for reverse engineer. So. Cool. All right.